Welcome back to Cavuto Coast to Coast. I'm Charles Payne in for Neil Cavuto, and we've got another very busy hour coming up. We just had an amazing jobs report and missed the estimates, but the details are phenomenal, including revisions to May and June that more than made up for the headline. Edward Lawrence is at the Labor Department with more. Edward.
Charles, the White House is actually saying that they're happy with this report. They're highlighting the positives that are in this report, like manufacturing jobs increasing. In fact, manufacturing created 37,000 jobs in July, that number on pace with what the June number was. So for the past 2 months, manufacturing in that sector has created 73,000 jobs. Now, add in another 19,000 jobs from construction, and that could indicate that there's investment from companies going forward. Now, economic advisor Larry Kudlow says that he's happy with the job numbers and the forecast from the Atlanta Federal Reserve that the third quarter growth will be 5%.
I actually thought it was a pretty strong report because the headline number was a little below estimate. But look, the back revisions were gigantic, 59,000. So really, you got to add that in. That gives you really 215 for the month of July.
And Kudlow ended up saying that you need to look at the trend over the last 3 months. In fact, this economy over the past 3 months has created 224,000 jobs per month there. Now, economists say that this report could also be good for the Federal Reserve to keep to their path of forecasting two more rate hikes this year. My sources in the Fed say they're really looking at the average hourly wages, and that number was 2.7% again this month for the 12 months preceding this. Now, if that number stays around the 2.7% level. Inside the Fed, they believe that inflation pressures will be lower. So the bottom line, this jobs report, good for the White House, good for the Federal Reserve. Charles?
Thank you very much, Edward. Now, the steady jobs gain, lower unemployment. One of the questions is why? Why don't we see wages picking up? And could that actually happen real soon? I want to go to Real Clear editor John Tamney, Payne Capital Management President Ryan Payne, and Stock Swoosh founder Melissa Armo. Let me start with you, John. It was a great report in my mind when I started looking at some of the details, particularly of some sectors. For instance, the U6 number going to 7.5 from 7.8. That to me reflects a wider breadth of people who were out of this job market, who were struggling and doing much better. But are you concerned about any element, particularly wages?
No. For one, you never look askance at 3.9%. But for two, it's at some point we've got to just throw out the ridiculous models happened upon by economists and just use common sense. Think about it. The U.S. has the most valuable companies in the world by far, at the high level, the mid level, the low level. Can you name any company in history that got that way without adding the best talent possible and paying that talent well? Is it really consistent with the market valuations placed on U.S. companies that somehow those businesses could routinely bilk workers at all levels? It defies basic common sense. Americans are paid very well. Who cares that economic statistics don't reveal what's obvious?
Melissa, what are your thoughts? The jobs report, we're up almost 100 points on the Dow. S&P is up for the fifth week in a row. We'll finish higher. And you know, NASDAQ 100, just a couple days ago, we were talking about it breaking under the 50-day moving average. Now it could be back to a double top real soon.
Well, you know what? People live and die by these numbers, which I think is ridiculous. This was a good number. It wasn't as expected. It's not the end of the world. And you know how I can figure that out? The market had no negative reaction today. We gapped up and opened up today. We had a huge rally yesterday. Apple came out. Their earnings were spectacular, made all brand new all-time highs. There's no reason to, you know, have a pity party because we didn't hit these exact numbers. These estimates, sometimes I think they overshoot what these estimates are want to be, but this is still a good, solid number. And you were talking about earlier this morning, and you were saying, you know what, if this was too big, then the Fed might say, oh, and then raise rates another extra time. So, I mean, I think it's good.
Goldilocks?
Goldilocks? No, I think we have to remember is, I mean, Goldilocks, actually the way it is, because we have modest inflation, and, you know, we're seeing the economy grow, we're seeing, you know, unemployment go up. You know, it's moderate. And that's all the things you want to see to keep this economy cooking. Because you got to remember, this is one of the slowest economic recoveries we've ever had at all time. We're not going to go to 0 to 60 overnight.
So say that again.
I said this is one of the slowest economic recoveries we've ever had.
Well, you mean over the 10-year that we've had expansion in the economy, right? But more recently, it has picked up a tremendous amount of steam.
Yeah, the GDP was great for last quarter, but I mean, you can't expect wages to just go skyrocketing overnight. I think that's going to take a while.
What about the overall economy, though? Can we expect, is 3% reasonable?
I think it's very realistic. I mean, you have capital expenditures coming back from corporations. You have, you know, people are spending money again, the government's spending money. This economy is heating up.
Listen, corporations aren't going to pay more unless they're forced to. I mean, if you own a company and you run a company, you're trying to save. I mean, that's the biggest expense that companies have is payroll. They're not going to pay more unless they absolutely have to.
Right. And of course, that's one of the things that was big on Janet Yellen's dashboard, the quits part of the JOLTS report, and that's starting to edge up, but not a lot. Now, John, I know you're not a big fan of tariffs, but the battle is joined, if you will. China announcing $60 billion in retaliatory tariffs, but I thought the more important news this morning was China taking measures to sort of slow the decline in their currency, which many people were saying, well, that was going to be their ace in a hole. What do you make of it all?
Well, I think we overrate this idea that you can devalue your way to prosperity. If that were true, then Zimbabwe would be the richest country on earth and Argentina would be number two. When you devalue your currency, you weaken your workers and you repel the very investment that drives corporate and job creation. Look at Japan. Japan had some of its best years of economic growth when the yen was soaring against the dollar. And so what's crucial is that the Chinese maintain that peg to the dollar. Let's never forget the only reason we're working is because we want to get things. The more that the Chinese get up and go to work every day, we Americans get a raise. Furthermore, China represents an increasingly large market for U.S. companies. Apple's the most valuable company in the world. Where does it get one quarter of its revenues from sales in China? Let's not mess up what's great for both countries.
Of course, Melissa, I think that's one of the issues we're trying to resolve, even greater access into China and the ability to do business there without giving up too much or giving up intellectual property or trade secrets.
Right. And that's what Trump is coming out doing all this. And again, it just goes back 100% conviction. Look at the market today. We came out with this. All this tariff stuff came out this morning before we opened and we didn't have any negative reaction. I was surprised. The market is holding tough. It's hanging tough. It's trying to hang in there. The market really likes Trump a lot. It's trying to shrug off this tariff news whenever it comes out. I think you got to give it a shot. You got to give them time. It could be a couple more months till all this gets straightened out, but China's fighting back. They're fighting back hard.
Well, you know, my thing, Ryan, is, and I talked about it last night on my show, I think this ultimately is the combination of art of the deal and art of war, right? Yeah. If you read art of the deal, you know why President Trump is fighting this fight in the first place. If you read the art of war, right, and there's some key components in there, like when you're victorious, you don't crush the opponent. You leave them an exit. In other words, I think we're going to find a place where we're going to have to, President Trump will have to find a place to declare victory, because there will be an inflection point. There could be.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, let's face it. At the end of the day, we import so much more from China than they import from us. So, I mean, we definitely have the upper hand here. Plus, China's economy is slowing. Our economy is really strong here. So this is just a negotiating ploy, and we'll probably win that battle, or, you know, that, whatever you want to call it, conflict. Right.
John, what's worrying you the most of all the things in this economy, including debt, which, you know what, we're sort of remiss because we don't talk about it a lot and we used to.
Well, debt rises when an economy is growing, and we know that for obvious reasons. No one's going to lend to a person or a business or even a country if they feel that that debt's not going to be paid back.
So that's a mistake I've been making with some of my relatives, but go ahead.
to some degree, that takes care of itself. What worries me is the trade stuff. Let's be clear. I don't buy into this notion that we have a strong hand versus China. Again, Apple gets a quarter of its revenues from sales in China. GM sold more cars in China in the first quarter than it sold in North America. Nike's number two market is China. Boeing sells one quarter of its planes in China. There are double the number of Starbucks in Shanghai than there are in New York City. Why on earth would we get in a war with a country that is still very poor? Imagine what a huge market there'll be for our world-leading companies once China actually gets rich. Let's not mess with what's good.
Right, but we do want access to that market because
we've already got the access.
Do we?
Look at the numbers. Why does Apple get a quarter of its revenues from sales in China?
It's still the number five smartphone maker in China, in part because of some things. I mean, anyone who does real business in China will tell you there are a lot of obstacles against American companies and American products. So that number could be even better if they would level the playing field to the same degree that we level it for their companies.
Go ahead. I agree with that. I mean, I think that's the point here is we definitely have room to negotiate, and I think you're going to see that. I think we're actually going to win this conflict.
I mean, it could be a win-win, Melissa. That's the whole thing. China obviously says that they would like to do more, rely less on exports and more on the domestic economy. You know, they have a huge amount of middle class that's grown over the years. And they're not going to always have this manufacturing, you know, advantage. They certainly won't have it against a neighboring country. Nike does more manufacturing of their sneakers in Vietnam now than they do in China. So they want domestic prices to be low, I would think, but it's just about freer or fairer sort of markets.
Right. That and also the intellectual property thing is a bugaboo. And so that is a problem for Trump as well. You know, when you look at it on the whole, let's just say this all works out to America's advantage. Trump keeps saying America first. Let's just say it all works out. You know what? The other countries of the world are going to look at Trump differently because they've had issue with him doing this to them as well. And China's been the biggest one that's been trying to stand up to Trump with the tariffs. If other countries are going to respect us more, if this works out with China.
Well, we're close to something with EU. We might get something over the weekend on NAFTA, and we'll all see. Hey, thank you all very much for the smart, passionate commentary. Have a great weekend. In the meantime, sticking with Apple, they continue to climb, now more than $1 trillion market cap. So what does Tim Cook need to do to really keep up the pace? Because when you're a winner, people expect even more from you. And of course, be sure to tune into my show tonight, Making Money at 6 p.m. Eastern. We're going to talk about a whole lot of things, not just Apple. Last night I told you about Smuckers. It's up $8 today. There are a lot of ways to make money in this market. We'll go over it tonight, 6 p.m.